Okay, let's start. So, who we are. So I'm a technician. I'm working since 10 years in a plant research institute, which is nearby, about 200 kilometers from Berlin. And our focus is to search for genes which are involved in plant pathogen interactions. And we use barley and powdery mildew as a model system. And here you can see barley plants, young barley plants, which are infected with powdery mildew, which is a major problem in the field outside. So you have a lot of losses due to this pathogen. And we try to find genes which are involved in these interactions by reverse genetics. So how we can do this? So you might know that the genome of high organisms are very large. So for instance, for barley, it's almost twice as big as the size of the human genome. And this means you have about 30,000 genes. So how to find genes which are involved in only in plant pathogen interactions? So how you can do this? And we use a tool which is called RNA interference, which was discovered in the 90s. And people thought they wanted to make petunia plants, which are light blue. They wanted to make it dark blue. And they thought, okay, we know the DNA gene for the blue color gene. And let's add more of this in the plant. And then we have petunia plants, which are dark blue. They did this. And actually what happened was exactly the reverse. So they found that the flowers are white, or they have only stripes of a blue color. And they scratched ahead and repeated experiments, but it's always turned out to be the same. And it took quite some years to find out that there's a mechanism behind this, which is called RNAi. So how does RNAi work? So if double-stranded RNA enters the cell, which is very unusual. So people think that this mechanism is used to defense against RNA viruses. So if double-stranded RNA enters the cell, it's recognized by an enzyme called Dicer, which can see here. And the Dicer cuts the double-stranded RNA into small pieces, which are about 21 base pair long, which are called small interfering RNA or siRNAs. Then another enzyme detects these small RNAs, take it, remove one of the strands, which is important for later. So only one of the two strands stays and builds a so-called RISC complex. This RISC complex then is attached to the target, which is the mRNA, which is here. And this binding of the RISC complex blocks the translation and you have no protein. So if we go back to our blue collar gene, so you have the natural blue collar gene in the plant, which is the mRNA. Oops, I lost my... So here you have the natural gene in the plant, and the people added more of the blue collar gene here, so the double-stranded RNA. This was recognized by the plant. It was bind to the natural gene and blocked the translation for the blue color. So you have no color anymore. So this is how it works. So with this, you can efficiently silence and knock down genes. And it works very well since many years. So people use it in human, in worms, in plants, in many species. And we also use it. So we have developed a testing system where we can use this tool. It's very efficient and very cool, I think. So that's why we call it reverse genetics. So if you don't know what to do, you switch off gene by gene and look what's happened. Okay, so people use it, but there are two problems with it. So the first problem is that you might have missed target of other genes. And the other problem is that not every silencing is efficient. So we wanted to make a software to predict these problems and also to use this tool for designing good and efficient constructs. So we wanted to make a software which can predict off targets, which can predict efficiency, And also, we wanted to test this software. So we made this software some years ago, but in the last year, we wanted to validate it and to make real experiments and to see whether this prediction is true. And of course, we want to have a nice software which runs on Windows and everybody can use it and combines all these features. So what is an off-target? So imagine that you have, you want to make a construct, so you want to knock out a gene. So you make, artificially, you can do this in the lab, you make double-stranded RNA construct, and then you have to check whether you only target your gene you want, and not only another target. So as I said, you have about 30,000 genes in the Bali genome, so the chance that you might hit another target is quite high. So as you can see here, so again, the double-stranded RNA split into small RNAs, and then we use a short reader liner, which is called Bautai over Python. And Bautai tried to find all the matches from the small interferon RNAs against a large database. For instance, the Bali genome or the human genome, whatever. And if you designed a good construct, you should only find hits of your target. But now and then you might have off target, which is here, which have, of course, much less hits, but they might be efficient enough also to cross silence, to have an off target effect. So you might not only hit your gene, which you want, but also other genes. Because, for instance, in Bali, it's very common that you have gene families which have the same sequence, so very similar sequence, and it might be that you hit also another gene from the same family, which you don't want usually. So it's important to predict this and to know it, and maybe to change your construct design, for instance. So then the question arises, how much similarity is required for being an off-target? And we used a theory, a model, which is called the molecular clock, which says that about every 1 million year in evolution, one nucleotide is changed. So if you have a common ancestor, which has the sequence like this, then after 1 million year, you have usually one base pair exchange. So here, for instance, I have to see, C turns to G, and here an A turns into T, and so on. So after 2 million years, we have another change. And we use this to design our experiments. So we constructed 15 constructs. We made them synthetic constructs, which have, so we used one target, which we know it works. So we worked since 10 years on this, and we have very good efficient constructs and targets and tested and everything. So we used our best candidate and made 15 constructs, synthetic constructs, with decreasing matching similarity. So you have so the 0 million years, so you have no change, so you have 100% identity. And first we did this in smaller steps, so 98%, 96%, so on, to 90% and then in larger steps. And then we run this over the short reader line, our Bautai, and you expect that the hits you get are decreasing as well as the identity. So in the best case, so 100%, you have 408 hits from the siRNAs to the target, and it decreases to zero at the end. So you have no, you don't hit anymore your target. Okay, so we made these constructs and we tested in our system, and unfortunately I have no time to explain how it works, so you have to trust me. here you can see all the constructs, and 100% means the constructs have no effect, they are under control, so the control is 100% here. And as much, as stronger they go down, as more they have the effect. So zero would be the best. And the red bars means that the construct is significant. So we usually do about 5 experiments. More we cannot afford because it's expensive and very laborious. And after 5 experiments, we do statistics, and then we see what stays significant or not. So the red means it's significant. The blue means has no effect, not significant. And you can see here, it's very interesting, that to the 4 million years, so to the 92% identity, you still have an effect. So this silencing works, you knocked out a gene. But starting from 90% to 50 million years, or to 30%, you have no effect anymore, you lost it. It's not working anymore. Now the question arrives by 90% you still have 59 hits of the from Bautai, from the alignment. So you have 59 siRNAs which match your target. So why you don't have an effect anymore? And this is raised the suspicion, or also what the people know since long time, that not each siRNA is efficient. So you might have siRNAs which are not efficient, and as you can see here, most likely it's like this. So these 59, you have it, but they are simply not efficient enough. So when we started to make the software, we used very basic rules to estimate which siRNAs are efficient, because people did not know exactly what's going on and what means this efficient. So we used stuff like A and U at the beginning, and the GC content and temperature. But in the last few months, we wanted to re-implement the software and to have a better prediction of the siRNA and also to confirm it with our experiments. So in the last couple of months, many research papers appear which tested a lot this efficiency, especially in humans, and it turned out that the thermodynamic properties are very important, also the structure of the RNA. So things like minimum free energy, self-folding, free ends, or target accessibility. So we use this, and the first very important thing is the strand selection. So you have the siRNAs here, and then they are bind to an argonaut, and one strand is removed, if you remember. So how does this happen? This happens like a zipper. And this happens if the less stable strand is easier removed and open, and this strand is taken from the wrist complete, and one strand is removed. So this goes over the minimum free energy. If it's larger, so it's less stable, it's removed from this side. But now you might have the problem that the wrong strand is removed. So it might be not complementary anymore to your mRNA. You might have gotten the wrong strand. So this siRNA is completely useless. So this we included in our software to remove, to make a strand selection, and to remove all those siRNA which are not targeted anymore. So we, all the calculations that we did after, we first run it over this strand selection to work only after with these which are really hitting the real target. The second thing which seems to be important, and it's published many articles, this is the target site accessibility of the target. So as you can see here, the RNA is this is the primary structure of the RNA, which is in the cell, it's not really like this. You have a lot of folding, so you can see here you have complementary bindings and loopings and such stuff, and this is the secondary structure, and this is the, and this is the actually how it looks in the cell. This is a very small RNA, and you see how much is folded and how much is going on, so it's not a flat line. And you can see already here that on some places it's easier to target it than on others. So if you have, for instance, a folding, a matching here it's very difficult to access for the siRNA because it's already double-stranded. So these parts of the loop, for instance, might be much easier to access. And you can calculate these things with a tool called RNA-PL-Fold, which we also use over Python, which calculates the local base pair probability. So it takes the siRNA and the target, part of the target. So we do this only on part of the target of the mRNA because it's much easier to calculate than on these structures. And it calculates the probability, how much, how accessible it is from the siRNA to the target. And you can do this for each base pair, but also for an average. So you can do this for the one mer, the two mer, and so on and so forth for the whole siRNA, so 21 mer. And people found that it seems to be reasonable results and also interpretable results if at least 8 base pairs of the siRNA can access the target. So I guess if it's less, so if it's like 2 or 3 base pairs, the energy might be not enough to stick the rest of the siRNA. And so people found that it's a good to take and to look on the data if there are at least 8 mirrors of the cyanide matching to the target. And this is what we did. So we took our constructs. So for simplicity, we checked for each of these mirrors. So 1 mirror, 2 mirror, and so on and so forth. For each construct, so for simplicity, I will show only the 8 mirror average because, as I said, we found the same that it looks the most reliable if you use 8 mirrors. And you have our constructs here, which were tested. So you can see here the position of the sequence position. So you have 500 base pairs of sequence of the target. And here it's shown the accessibility. So 0 means this site or this position of the target was not accessible. And 1 means it was very accessible. And you can see here, so if you remember, the 0 million years and to the 4 million years had an effect, and the 5 million years not. So you can see here that for the 0 million years, the 1, the 2, and the 3, and the 4 have quite a lot of accessible sites. So this is the last construct with an effect, and it still has quite some accessible sites, where for the 5 million construct, they completely disappear. So this fits to our data. So with this, you can efficiently say, say how efficient are the cyRNAs you make with this construct. If you look more closer to the first construct, to the 0 million years, you actually can see that you have clusters. So for instance, from 0 to 100 base pairs, you have not so many accessible sites. From 100 to 200, you have some. From 200 to 300, you also have some. And from 300 to 400, you have none, or not only very few. And from 400 to 500, you have quite a lot. So this brings us to the idea to make 5 other constructs, which are called, which we call window constructs, where only these 100 base pairs match to the target. So you have from 1 to 100 a match, which match only the target, and the rest is random sequence. So it will not match the target. Then from 100 to 200, 200 to 300, 300 to 400, and 400 to 500. So we created these constructs and tested in our system. And the results looks quite interesting. I have to say that I just stopped to look at the results before I went to the conference. We are not finished yet with this. But it looks already quite interesting. So we got the strongest and most significant effect with 400 and 500 base pair constructs, which you also corresponds very good to the accessible sites. So you have a lot. And we have no significant effect with 300 to 400, where there are also no accessible sites. And for 200 and 100, it's similar. The only what makes us a little bit prominent is the 1-200 window construct. But as I said, we still look on the data, and it's also we have to find here a threshold and to define a threshold because this what was known from the human does not fit to the plan. Okay, then already I want to come to an end. So we created a software which is called SciFi, which can be downloaded and run on at the moment on Windows. At the moment, I'm making it cross-platform with PyQt. I switched the GUI framework. You can have a custom database. You can find efficient siRNAs, and you can recommend and find missed target genes. And this is just a screenshot how it looks like. So I think it's very useful, and I wanted to make this talk just to show that also non-programmers can do quite useful things with Python, and can also, it's accepted from the community. Soon we will publish an article about it, and I hope you liked it.
How fast is this library? How much? I have no idea how long such a sequence is. Can you handle
the database?
Yes, if you have some piece of RNA and want to do something with this, how much data is there in it?
It's a lot of data.
And is this done in a batch process then?
Yes, or? It's run in a batch process, and but I use database indexing to do this very fast. Okay. So I'm not, I don't know exactly the details, but it's do it very efficiently. So one check from the software takes about 5 seconds. So it's quite fast at the end.
Yeah, hello. So I have two questions, actually. So I'm seeing you using BioPython, right? Do you use that to do your blasts?
No. Or what, against? So we tried blast at the beginning,
yeah.
But it was performing very bad for short sequences. Oh. So you have a lot of mistakes, actually. So it does not find all the siRNAs which are actually there. So if you look on this graph, on the first graph, you can see on the blue line, so this was just taken to align all the siRNAs. With BLAST, you will not have this line. You have gaps in between. It cannot find all the siRNAs, and that's why we switched to Bowtie. BioPython I just mentioned here because I use it for some handy tools like converting the reverse complementing and open files, faster files, and such stuff.
So this is not either, you're using this not at all to... Because you were saying in the beginning you're trying to find the off targets as well, right? That's also part of the software.
Yes, it's also part. So this we do with Bowtie.
Okay.
So we split. I split in Python the query sequence to 21 MERS or whatever length you like, and then I take this sequence and use Bowtie to find it in my database, which is also made in Bowtie. And Bowtie gives me, for instance, the hit, which you can see it here. So this is actually, it's good. This is the target you want to hit. But you might have off targets. So this also comes. So this is another a gene. And you might have here in this region, you might have off targets. So this is done through Bowtie.
Okay. And
so this is like, just maybe I can show. So this is, you know, if you have query and target, which are the same, and you split it, you will find each of these substrings on the target here. So you have 8 hits. But if you have a mismatch in between, so an X here, you will find only 3. You know, it's like this. And for this, we use Bowtie.
Yeah. And just, I was wondering whether those target size predictions, they are based on the secondary structure in some way. You do it?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Right. So I just started to work with it, and we tried to find thresholds, and maybe also we go for machine learning and stuff like this. But as I said, I'm not professional programmer. I need some time to develop all this.
Great, okay, thanks.
You said that you are using Bowtie as a short read assembler against probably some short reads. What I didn't get, maybe I misunderstood it. Where did the short reads come from? From what?
Yes, so you have you can enter your, in the software here, you can paste your query sequence. So we call it query sequence.
Yes.
And then in Python, I just split it. So I split it to, so here you can choose the size.
No, that wasn't what I meant. I mean, okay. if you want to do a bow tie, you sort of, what are you doing it against? Against the Bali genome or some short?
Yes, you can. So this is a very big advantage of sci-fi. So all the tools which exist online and also for downloading, you cannot use a custom database. So they're usually for human. So siRNAs is usually very often used in human. Everything is adapted for human. But this is useless for us. So we need to check against the Bali genome or whatever. So you can make a customized database. And you can check against this. And this is very important because, you know, the sequencing of the Bali genome is ongoing, and you might have next week completely different sequence than last week. So we need to be very flexible here.
Okay, so the Bowtie is used against the published reference genome.
Yes,
assembly.
Or your own. So sometimes you have projects where you have confidential data. So that's why we also don't go online at the moment.
And not the short, some kind of short read library that you acquired.
No, no. So. You can do this if you like. So you can download them and paste them and use it. But so we wanted to be very flexible at this point because all the other servers are not.
Very interesting. Thank you.
Thank you.